You know, HIV is the greatest pandemic in recorded human history. So it's huge. And as far as we know, humankind has never experienced anything like this before. Typically, when it enters a country and gets started, there are certain groups that are most affected. But then gradually that changes and it becomes mainstream and it becomes everybody's problem. And that has now happened in most countries around the world and certainly in India. Well, if you go back to 2002, 2003, not so long ago, essentially no one in the developing world, except for a very few wealthy people who lived in large cities, had access to antiretroviral therapy. Now, increasingly, people who need this therapy are receiving it. It's very important that the individual concerned is getting the right drugs and that they really take them as recommended. So adherence, compliance, that's really critical.
We'd been doing a lot of work in adherence here in the US, and we knew that the drugs were about to hit in a big way in the developing world with a global fund, with the generics, with the governments getting involved, and yet nobody even knew something as simple as how do you measure adherence in this setting? Do our measures work that we have developed here for the West? Do the barriers that we've studied here, are those the same barriers in India? And how can you make sure that people are taking the medication the way they're supposed to if you don't know what barriers to ask them about?
St. John's National Academy of Health Sciences is one of India's state-of-the-art clinical training and research centers. Their mission includes serving the underserved. UCSF's Dr. Maria Ekstrand is collaborating with Indian health leaders at St. John's to study barriers to antiretroviral therapy adherence, working closely with leaders like Dr. Girja Singh.
और हमारे तरफ से जो patient types है, वो काफी अलग है। जो USA में, UK में, West में जो मिलेंगे आपको patients, यहाँ पर काफी अलग है। हमारे जो problems होते हैं, जो treatment के लिए जो अभी study कर रहे हैं adherence of antiretroviral therapy, तो हमारे problems बिल्कुल अलग हैं।
You cannot import and transplant something from the West to the East or vice versa. We're such a huge country and so diverse. And what works with the affluent may not work with the unaffluent or the poorer. What works with tribal communities will not work with urban communities. So it's actually understanding this diversity that is India and what will work where and how and why and what will not work where and how and why.
I have to say that I learn as much from them when I go there as they learn from me. I can come there with a technical knowledge. I know how to design a survey. I know how to set up a research protocol. But I could not do this on my own.
The people doing capacity building don't necessarily have to be from the country where the training is taking place, but they must understand the socio-economic, cultural ethics, practices, values, and all that kind of thing is very important.
दवाई लेने में पेशेंट को सिर्फ दवाई लिखना ही इम्पोर्टेंट नहीं है. दवाई निगलने तक कितनी इतनी प्रॉब्लम्स होती है उसको. इतना सरल नहीं है जितना पेपर में दिखाया जाता है कि दवा दे दिए अब पेशेंट ठीक हो गया. नहीं, ऐसा नहीं है. काफ़ी अड़चन होते हैं बीच में. पेशेंट को दवा पहुँचने तक काफ़ी अड़चन है. एक तो पेशेंट खुद नहीं लेना चाहते दवा, क्योंकि इसके मतलब नाम खराब हो जाएगा. फैमिली में किसी को नहीं मालूम होना, ड्रग के रिएक्शंस होते हैं तो छुपा छुपा के करते हैं. यहाँ पर स्टिग्मा होता है कि ये बीमारी को अभी तक कोई खुल के बात नहीं करता है इस बारे में. तो दवा होने के बावजूद पेशेंट नहीं लेते हैं, तो इसमें काफ़ी अड़चन है. यहाँ के जो सोशल स्ट्रक्चर है, यहाँ के जो हमारे प्रॉब्लम्स है, वो इतनी आसानी से हम ओवरकम कर नहीं सकते.
मेरा नाम लक्ष्मी है. छः साल हो मुश्किल होती, बहुत दूर से आना जाना, पैसे का मुश्किल, गाड़ी का मुश्किल, ऐसा ऐसा मुश्किल हो रही. एक एक पर जाने को होता नहीं, तभी ठीक नहीं होती है, सिर दर्द आती है, ऐसा ऐसा होते भी थोड़ा प्रॉब्लम हो रही.
What we're finding when we're doing this work in India is that even asking someone to take a pill twice a day or three times a day can be a huge deal. And I didn't really understand it that well until I went in and started talking to our patients. And a woman came up to me and she had tears in her eyes and she was so upset and she said, can you please, please just take the message back that somebody has to come up with a pill that I can get away with just taking once a day? And I said, I think people are working on that, but tell me why that's so important for you. And she said, because I can't get privacy twice a day or three times a day. She said, even getting 30 seconds to myself to sneak away and take this one pill so nobody notices once a day is a huge deal, especially if it is for the rest of my life. But to do it two or three times a day, it's impossible.
तो आप बता रही थी कि जैसे आपको क्या तकलीफ होती है दवाई लेने में घर में खुले में ले सकती हैं कि मतलब छुपाए छुपाए लेना पड़ता है
नहीं नहीं किसी को नहीं मालूम मेरा बहन को मालूम किसी को नहीं मालूम
अच्छा किसी को नहीं मालूम
नहीं मालूम बहन को मालूम बहन बोलती है इनको टीबी इसलिए नहीं खा रही जीजा को मेरा जीजा को बोल रही ये क्या रोज रोज भी दवाई खाती है ऐसे सब बोल रही जीजा पूछती बहन को बहन बोलते इनको टीबी है नहीं बहुत वीकनेस है ना इसलिए ये खाती मालूम पड़ा नहीं पड़ा मालूम नहीं जीजा को मालूम होगा ऐसा ऐसा मैं ऐसा वो कोई नहीं मालूम
The poor people, they live in one room. They don't have the physical space to have that privacy, right? It's a very different concept for me and it's very different for the man on the streets or the poor people. There should be an understanding that while certain fundamental issues are the same around the world, you know, the need for dignity, the need for privacy and all that, the fact is one has to see it in the socio-economic cultural context of every country differently. In our society, the family is much stronger than anything else. And what might be seen as an interference in your everyday life is probably valued by us much more here. And so the fact that your father, your mother, your grandparents, your aunts and uncles might have a stake in your life, I think we appreciate that.
So you say, well, you know, have you thought about telling your family or telling your friends? You know, maybe they'd be supportive. And they'll say things like, well, I can tell my brother, I can tell my oldest brother, or I can tell my sister-in-law, but of all the people who live in the house, it's very likely that there's somebody who doesn't know. So you have to be discreet.
Because of the stigma and discrimination, confidentiality and privacy is of absolute paramount importance.
Privacy is of the utmost importance because culturally subjects like sexuality are seldom discussed. This poses a unique challenge since many clinics in India afford little privacy and don't lend themselves well to discussions about HIV.
और चामराजनगर में लोगों को कितना अवेयरनेस है एचआईवी एड्स के बारे में बहुत लोगों को कि
कम लोगों को है अभी अभी ज़्यादा ज़्यादा कर रही ना अभी भी ज़्यादा होना अभी भी अवेयरनेस होना विलेज में बहुत कम है अवेयरनेस बहुत पे कम है टाउन में अच्छा है सिटी में अच्छा है विलेज में कम है अवेयरनेस अभी ज़्यादा होना
The US epidemic started off as a gay male epidemic, and San Francisco was one of its epicenters. The Indian epidemic has been different in different parts of India. India is a very, very large country, and so it has not been uniform throughout India. In the northeast of India, for example, intravenous drug use has been at the heart of the spread of HIV. But more typically in India, it was heterosexual from the beginning and has maintained itself as a primarily heterosexual epidemic. I mean, the great spreaders of HIV everywhere are what I like to call MMM, mobile men with money. It's a very common pattern for a man to leave his wife and his village, go and find work, contract HIV, possibly from contact with female sex workers, possibly in other ways, and bring it back to his village and infect his wife.
पहले भी अवेयरनेस कर रही ना इसलिए बोलती ऐसा ऐसा नहीं जाना, ऐसे जाते भी सेफ सेक्स करना ऐसा बोलते, किसी भी ऐसा जवान लड़के को कम है ना इधर, जवान लड़के को इधर कम है, फैमिली में ज़्यादा है.
The number one risk factor in India for women for contracting HIV is being married. So being married puts you at risk more than any other factor. Women often don't have very much power in the relationship. Many Indian women do. Many Indian women are terrifically powerful. I think when I go and visit medical schools in India, I'm struck by the number of female deans I see, the female heads of departments, more so than in the US. But for the majority of women, they definitely have less power in the family.
तो हस्बैंड कहीं भी बाहर जाके उसको एचआईवी लेके वापस आके औरत को दे सकता है. अगर वो चाहती भी है कि कॉन्डम्स यूज़ करने के लिए, हस्बैंड को बोलने के लिए मुंह नहीं खोल सकते हो. अगर कभी कभी कुछ सीख गए और बोल भी दी तो मार पड़ेगा उसका. लेकिन ये जो मेजर इशू है इसको टैकल करना इतना आसान नहीं है, क्योंकि ये सोशल इशू है. ये सिर्फ ऐसा नहीं है कि सिर्फ एचआईवी के बारे में, ये सिर्फ औरत का पढ़ाई के बारे में है, एम्पावरमेंट के बारे में है. तो इट्स अ वेरी मेजर, आई डोंट नो हाउ टू सॉल्व इट, इट्स अ वेरी वेरी डिफिकल्ट.
Even if they do get in and they get treatment, many of the barriers to taking their medication and getting follow-up care are doubled or even quadrupled, because women are less mobile typically. They may have more household responsibilities that are harder for them to leave. They may not be allowed to travel alone, so not only does it become a matter of them getting the time to go to the clinic, but they may have to have a male relative with them. It becomes more of an ordeal.
So there are so many social factors that affect their lives, and this is not just true of, you know, the poor people. It's also often true of the more affluent women.
Well, there is a big connection in most countries, perhaps in every country, in every culture, between the status and empowerment of women and the spread of HIV.
जब तक औरत को आप थोड़ा strong नहीं कर सकेंगे हमारे देश में, तो हमारा देश का problem बिल्कुल अलग है. काफ़ी साल लगेंगे, इतना सोशल चेंज लाने में साल लगेंगे. तो उसके लिए कोलाबरेटिव वर्क, तो ये जो प्रोजेक्ट डॉक्टर मारिया कर रही है, इसमें तो पेशेंट को खाली दवा देने से नहीं होगा, तो इसमें काफ़ी काउंसलिंग की ज़रूरत होती है.
काउंसलिंग में हिम्मत मिलती ना, हिम्मत आती है ना. मेरा से कितना लोग है इनके पास जाना बोलना, काउंसलिंग में ही नहीं ना, इसलिए पूरा इंसान बोलना नहीं कहते, दिल में रखते हैं, कुछ भी होता नहीं, किसी को मालूम पड़ता नहीं, हेल्प कुछ भी मिलता नहीं, पूरा इंसान बोलना हेल्प होती. और पॉजिटिव पीपल्स मिलते इनके भी बोलते, हमें भी ऐसा है, 6 साल में है, देखो मैं कैसा जिंदा हो, ऐसा ऐसा बोलते.
In addition to counseling services, UCSF has an interest in learning more about why non-medical approaches such as mindfulness and holistic health techniques lead to increased adherence.
A lot of our patients were saying, we don't just want to survive. We want to live in a hopeful way. We want to have hope. We want to have quality of life. We don't just want to merely survive. So we talked to them some more about this, and we went out in the community and talked with other groups who are trying to serve some of those needs. We talked to people who were teaching HIV-infected patients better nutritional habits so that they would hopefully boost their immune system and be healthy. And we talked to people who were doing dance and dance therapy and how to get in touch with your body that way. And the fun that you have when you're exploring your body and you are making it do all these wonderful things in dance or in yoga. Positive, uplifting, hopeful activities.
सब जो जिंदगी में आनंद नहीं होगा तो वो क्या, डिजीज कहिए और जो भी टेंशन कहिए, कुछ नहीं क्लियर होगा. आनंद अपना जॉय, लेकिन जॉय ऐसा नहीं होने चाहिए, जॉय साधना के माध्यम में होने चाहिए. वो कथक योगा के माध्यम में हम लोग को उन लोगों को सिखाएगा. अपना गुरु को तुम अपना पहला समझा करो, तुम अपने को समझो आगे. सेल्फ अवेयरनेस अपना नाच के माध्यम में, शरीर के प्रति अपना जो ध्यान होने चाहिए, तो इस शरीर के प्रति जो ध्यान है इसी के माध्यम में अपना शांति मिलती है.
In some way, I think this was the more meaningful piece for them because it made them feel good about who they were, and it made them feel good about their childhoods, and it made them feel empowered because these were all techniques they had control over and they could do with very little resources.
If you look at HIV/AIDS challenges worldwide, and India is no exception to this, there is the challenge of getting more people to adhere and maintain the therapy for decades. It's not so easy, it's a big challenge. So depending on the culture and circumstances in the country, these non-medical approaches are of great interest and should certainly be further explored, as UCSF is doing.
Jisko HIV, they may not be able to do. Kina unko to bahut very weak, very weak. Kya kar sakta hai unko ko liye? Khali khali bed bed ke khali. कॉन्सेंट्रेशन करेगा तो प्रेशर निकल जाएगा. खाली बैठ के कोऑर्डिनेशन कोऑर्डिनेशन एंड हैप्पीनेस सिंगिंग एंड कोऑर्डिनेशन तो लोग सोचेंगे. जैसा जितना सोचेंगे उतना लोग प्रेशर से निकल आते रहेंगे. तो अब मेरा ख्याल से एक्सपेरिमेंट करने चाहिए ये, क्यों ना भगवान जाने कैसा ये, इसको क्या फ़ायदा होगा ये तो हम नहीं कह सकते हैं. हम तो साइंटिस्ट नहीं हैं.
So learning about yoga or meditation or dance or nutritional habits or what their legal rights are, I see as equally important pieces to any adherence intervention.
UCSF से हमको अच्छा काफी नए ideas मिलते हैं, तो हमको ऐसे कोई चाहिए जो हमको थोड़ा उत्साह है कि हम भी research करें, कुछ नई सिरे से सोचें, और इसके लिए वो बहुत जरूरी है कि ऐसा कोई collaboration होना जरूरी है, मिलके काम करना, I think.
I love working in India. I have really terrific, compassionate, smart, dedicated collaborators. I feel like we have an opportunity to make a difference. So that's where I'm focusing my energy.
I'm delighted that we have so many UCSF colleagues who are engaged in different aspects of HIV work with Indian collaborators and other scientists and public health workers. I think it's a responsibility we have, and I think it's welcomed by our Indian counterparts, and will hopefully accelerate India's response to the HIV/AIDS epidemic and help our colleagues in India to implement more effective policies both in prevention and treatment.